हेलो एवरीवन, वेलकम टू ITLS एकेडमी। टुडे इन द मॉड्यूल ऑफ मेडिकल बायोकेमिस्ट्री आई एम गोइंग टू कवर द टॉपिक केमिस्ट्री ऑफ लिपिड्स। सो दिस इज द आउटलाइन ऑफ दिस प्रेजेंटेशन इज दैट वी विल टू बी फर्स्ट कवरिंग अ मेजर कॉन्सेप्ट इन विच वी विल टॉक अबाउट व्हाट आर द लिपिड्स, द क्लासिफिकेशन एंड द बायोमेडिकल इंपॉर्टेंस। In which we will specifically ask for, you know, define lipids, what are the Bloer's criteria to call a compound as a lipid. We will classify the lipids and learn the three major groups with examples of each group. And parallelly, we will talk about the biochemical, medical importance of lipids in general. Second, we will talk about we will list the derived lipids of biological importance and learn their chemistry and properties. Then we will talk about the simple lipids of their biological importance and we will learn their chemistry and properties as well. We will also talk about the compound lipids, their biological importance, and we will also talk about their chemistry and the properties. So if we start with first, what are the lipids? The lipids generally constitute a very important heterogeneous group of organic substances which are present in the animal tissues or plants and related either actually or potentially to the fatty acid. Chemically, there are various types of esters of different alcohols, and in addition to alcohol and fatty acids, some of the lipids may contain phosphoric acid, nitrogenous base and carbohydrates. On the basis of the Bloer's criteria, according to Bloer, lipids are compounds which have the following characteristics. They are insoluble in water. The solubility in one or more organic solvents such as ether, benzene, chloroform, acetone, etc. They are generally named as fat solvents. There are some relationship to the fatty acids and esters, either a potential or actual. They have a possibility of utilization by living organisms. Now, generally the lipids include the fats, oils, waxes and related compounds. Now, first we will start with the classification of lipids, and we will talk about the simple lipids, compound lipids, derived lipids, and lipid-associated substances. So, in this slide, if you can see here, and these are the different classes of the lipids which have a individual examples are present in it. For example, simple lipids are also known as waxes and fats, and they are named as considered as esters of fatty acid with various alcohols, for example, neutral fats or waxes. Compound lipids, they are also esters of fatty acid which contains group other than or in addition to alcohol and fatty acids, apart from that, like for example, phospholipids, glycolipids, sulfolipids, amino lipids, and lipoproteins. Then we have a derived lipids, which are derivatives obtained by the hydrolysis of those given in simple and compound lipids. Then you have miscellaneous, you can say, or the lipid-associated substances. For example, aliphatic hydrocarbons, carotenoids, squalene, vitamin K and E. So we will start first from the simple lipids, and we will talk about their physical properties. As I mentioned, that simple lipids are the esters of fatty acids with various alcohols. If we talk about their physical properties, so they are the neutral fats, which are the triesters of the trihydric alcohol, glycerol, with various fatty acids. They are insoluble in water but soluble in organic fat solvents. The specific gravity of all fats is less than 1. Consequently, all fats float in water. They have emulsification properties, that the emulsions of fat may be made by shaking vigorously in water, and then you can use also emulsifying agents, for example, soap, gum or any kind of protein, which actually produces more stable emulsions. Then with respect to the melting point and consistency, the hardness or consistency of fats is related to their melting point. Glycerides of lower fatty acid melt at low temperature than those of the higher fatty acids, and the unsaturated fatty acids, which are basically still at the low temperature. Now, if you look at here and if you talk about the chemical properties, so here in you can see that this is a triolene, which basically in the hydrolysis converts into glycerol and oleic acids. So the fats may be hydrolyzed with superheated steam by acids or alkalis, or you can also use a specific fat splitting enzyme, for example, lipases. Now, there are certain additive reactions. For example, the unsaturated fatty acid, which are present in neutral fat, exhibits all the additive reactions, for example, halogenations or hydrogenation. They also have oxidation properties. Fats which are very rich in unsaturated fatty acids such as linseed oil undergo the spontaneous oxidation generally at the double bond, and it forms the aldehydes, ketones and resins which form the transparent coating on the surfaces to which the oil is applied. These are called drying oils and are used in the manufacture of varnishes and paints. The another property is known as rancidity. The unpleasant odor and a taste which is developed by most of the natural fats on aging is generally referred to as rancidity. Now we'll talk about the dried lipids, which are also known as the fatty acids. An organic acid which basically occurs in a natural triglyceride is a monocarboxylic acid, which have a range of a chain length from C14 to almost about 24 carbon atoms. And the fatty acids are obtained always from the hydrolysis of the fats. So there are different types of fatty acids which are named as straight chain fatty acids. For example, they further classified into saturated and unsaturated fatty acids, and these are here the list of the saturated and unsaturated fatty acids. Now apart from the acetic acid and propionic acid, there are like butyric acid, caproic acid, palmitic acid. These are also the another examples of saturated fatty acids. Saturated fatty acids generally have the 10 carbon atoms, so they have a less number of carbon atoms, and they're generally also known as the lower fatty acids. They're also having a more than 10 carbon atoms, which are called the higher fatty acids. For example, palmitic, as I mentioned earlier. Milk contains the significant amount of the lower fatty acid, which are also known as the straight chain fatty acids. And when I mentioned about the unsaturated fatty acids, they are further classified according to the degree of unsaturation. For example, as I listed here, these are monounsaturated as well. In here, they can have a monoethanoid fatty acids. They contain generally one double bond. The general formula is C11H2N-1COOH. And the example of these are oleic acid, which is found in nearly all fats. And apart from that, there is another category called polyunsaturated. Sorry for the spelling mistake. Here is, this could be the monounsaturated. Now, if you talk about the polyunsaturated, the examples are, for example, three polyunsaturated fatty acids, which have a biological importance as well. You must have heard about, in general, that is a linoleic acid, and which is generally present in sufficient amounts in the peanut oil, corn oil, soya bean oil and the egg yolk. There is another called linolenic acid series, which contains the three double bonds, and the dietary source for those are they are generally present in the rapeseed oil and the linseed oil, soya bean oil, liver oil, which is generally known as a cod liver oil. The another class is called arachidonic acid series, which contains the four double bonds, and the dietary source for those are particularly, they generally found in the peanut oil. They also found in the animal fats, including the liver fats. So, in general, there are three polyunsaturated fatty acids, as I mentioned, linoleic, linolenic, and arachidonic acid, which are also known as essential fatty acids. So, they cannot be synthesized in the body, and they must be provided in the diet. That's why they are known as the essential fatty acids. The lack of essential fatty acids in the diet can produce the growth retardation and other deficiency manifestation symptoms as well. Apart from the two classes we mentioned, the saturated and unsaturated fatty acids, dried lipids also has sometimes branched-chain fatty acids, which are the sebaceous glands you must have heard about, which contains the branched-chain fatty acids. And there are a lot of branch in fatty acid which are present in a certain food. For example, phytonic acid is in, for example, in butter. So the question here is asked is why or which essential fatty acid is important. So linoleic acid is most important, as arachidonic acid can be synthesized from the linoleic acid by a three-stage reaction. You just simple, there is an addition of acetyl-CoA. Biologically, arachidonic acid is very important, as it is a precursor from which prostaglandins and leukotrienes are synthesized in the body. Now, what are the functions and the biomedical importance of essential fatty acids? First, they are considered as a structural elements of tissues. They are also considered as a structure element of gonads, for example, because, and they suggest the importance of these compounds in the reproductive function. Synthesis of prostaglandins and other compounds, they are generally synthesized by the cyclooxygenase enzyme system. They're considered as a structural element of mitochondrial membrane. They have a major effect on clotting time. They have a deficiency of essential fatty acids produces the fatty liver. They have a very important role in the vision, as docahexaenoic acid is the most abundant polinoic fatty acids present in the retinal photoreceptor membrane. Now, how do you basically identify the fats and the oil? What are the reactions through which you can actually figure it out which lipids are there and which fats or oils are present? So there is one property called saponification number, you must have heard about it, in which the number of milligrams of the potassium hydroxide is basically required to saponify the free and combine the fatty acid in 1 gram of a given fat, which is called a saponification number. The basis for saponification number is that you have an amount of alkali which is needed to saponify a given quantity of a fat that depends upon the number of COOH group present. Thus, fats which contain the short fatty acids will have more COOH groups per gram than long chain fatty acids, and that this will take more alkali and hence will have a higher saponification number. So on the basis of that, you can identify the fats and oils. The second is acid number, which is defined as the number of milligrams of KOH required to neutralize the fatty acids in gram of fat, which is called the acid number. The significance for acid number is it indicates the degree of rancidity, which we have earlier talked about, of the given fat. And the another is called iodine number, which is again defined as the number of grams of iodine which is absorbed by 100 gram of fat. The significance and use of iodine number is that it is a measure of the degree of unsaturation of a fat. If you've identified what is the unsaturation and how much unsaturation is there in the fat, so in that case, the more the iodine number, the greater the degree of unsaturation, because there will be absorption of more of the iodine molecules. Now, we will talk about here about the alcohols, which is another class of the lipids. So here the alcohols contained in the lipid molecule, these are not considered as a class, these are the molecules or a moiety which is present in the lipid molecule. That includes glycerol, cholesterol and the higher alcohols, for example, cetyl alcohol. So here is, this is the molecular formula of the glycerol, which is shown here in the right bottom. It is the simplest trihydric alcohol, as it contains three hydroxyl groups in the structure. Here we are first talking about the glycerol, which is a simple alcohol. It is the simple trihydric alcohol, as it contains three hydroxyl groups in the molecule and it is easily miscible with the water and the alcohol in all proportions, but is almost insoluble in ether. In body, glycerol has a definite nutritive value because it can be converted to glucose and glycogen, a process you must have heard about, gluconeogenesis. The role in medicine is that the nitroglycerin is used as a vasodilator and it is used in as a cholesterol therapy in cerebrovascular diseases, which basically reduces the cerebral edema. Now the another alcohol moiety is that which is present in the lipid molecule is cholesterol, which is the important sterol in human body, and this is the structure. The Norum's disease, which is considered as a genetic deficiency of lecithin cholesterol acyl transferase. Now we will talk about the compound lipids, which are also known as the phospholipids and glycolipids. These are the examples of compound lipids. Phospholipids are the compound lipids. They contain, in addition to fatty acids and glycerol or other alcohol, a residue which is phosphoric acid or a nitrogen and a nitrogen containing base and other substituents. Based on the type of alcohol present in the phospholipids, they are classified further. For example, glycerophosphatids, in which the glycerol is the alcohol group, for example, phosphocholine, ethanol, amine. And then you have phosphoinositides, in which inositol is the alcohol group, for example, phosphatidyl inositol. Then you have phosphosphingosides. Here, alcohol present is sphingosine, and the example is sphingomyelin. Now, what are the biological importance of the phospholipids? The first, if we talk about the phosphatidylcholine, it is widely distributed in animals and liver, brain, nervous tissues, nerve tissues, sperm, egg, yolk, and they have both structural and the metabolic functions. In plants also, it is present and particularly abundant in seeds and sprouts. The another example is the phosphatidyl ethanol amine. It is structurally identical to the choline, with the exception that the base ethanol amine replaces the choline. Both alpha and beta cephalins are known, and they occur within lecithin, for example, particularly rich in nervous tissues and brain. The another example is PI, which is in which inositol is a constitutive phospholipids, and they were first discovered in the Bacillus bacteria, and it was found to occur in brain and again in the nervous tissues, moderately in soybeans, and it's also found to be present in plant phospholipids. The another is phosphatidyl serine. It is in place of ethanol amine, amino acid serine is present. It is also found in nervous tissues and brain, and there's a small amount of in other tissues. It is also found in the blood. Then we have sphingomyelins. It's found in large and major quantities in brain and nervous tissue, and very small amount in other tissues. There's a deficiency of the enzyme called sphingomyelinase. There's a disease called Nickman Peak disease, which results in the accumulation of these. Now we have phosphatidic acid and glycerol. These are again important intermediate in the synthesis of TG and phospholipids, but is not found in any, you know, great quantities in tissue. They are present in very small quantities. Then we have cardiolipin, a phospholipid which is found in mitochondria and the bacterial wall. Now, what are the functions of phospholipids? If we talk about the structural function, they participate in the lipoprotein complexes, which are throughout to constitute the cell wall matrix and the membranes, the myelin sheath, and also this is present in the structures in microsomes and mitochondria. They play a very important role in blood coagulation. They have an iron transport and secretion property. They play a very important role in enzyme action, in which the certain enzymes, they require tightly bound phospholipids for their actions. For example, mitochondrial enzyme system involved in oxidative phosphorylation. They have a major role in electron transport. They have also major role in insulation, is that the phospholipids are myelin sheets. They provide the insulation around the nerve fibers. They also act as a cofactor, because they are required as a cofactor for the activity of the enzyme lipoprotein lipase and triacylglycerol lipase. They have a role in calcium-dependent hormone action, for example, phosphatidyl inositides. Now, the another class we will talk about is the glycolipids. These are the example for these are cerebrosides, or you can also name that as glycosphingosides. A cerebroside is considered to be built on the following: sphingosine. It is basically a fatty acid of high molecular weight, and it is usually a galactose, but sometimes maybe glucose. Generally, there is no glycerol, no nitrogenous base, no phosphoric acid. A cerebroside on hydrolysis yields a sugar, usually galactose, a high molecular weight fatty acid, an alcohol, sphingosine or dihydrosphingosine. They generally occur in large amounts in the white matter of the brain and in the myelin sheaths of nerve. The clinical aspects for glycolipids are that it is found to be associated with a disease called Gaucher's disease. It is an inherited disorder of cerebrosides metabolism, which is also known as lipidosis. There is a deficiency of the enzyme beta-glucose cerebrosidase, which is a lysosomal enzyme. So in that case, there's an accumulation, and that leads to this particular disease called Gaucher's disease. Now there is another called gangliosides. The highest concentrations are found in the gray matter of brain. Structure on hydrolysis, gangliosides, they yield the following. Majorly there is a long chain fatty acids, alcohol, sphingosine. There's a carbohydrate moiety which contains glucose, either glucose or galactose. There is also a molecule of acetylgalactosamine. This is a quite huge structure which contains these particular molecules. There are certain types of gangliosides, that is GM1, GM2, GM3, GD4, and these are the key molecules which are attached in their structure. Gangliosides also possess certain clinical importance. For example, GM1 is a more complex one, which is derived from GM3, and it is a considerable biological interest because it is now known to be the receptor in the human intestine for cholera toxin. The another is Tay-Sachs disease, which is a GM2. So there's a deficiency of enzyme called hexosaminidase A. There's an accumulation of a lot of gangliosides in brain and nervous tissues that leads to Tay-Sachs disease. GM1 gangliosidosis, due to the deficiency of enzyme called beta-galactosidase, there's an accumulation of GM1 gangliosides, glycoproteins, and the mucopolysaccharide keratin sulfate. Then we have a sulfolipid. This is the most abundant lipid which is found in the white matter of brain. The sulfolipids appear to be sulfate esters of glycolipids. The sulfate group is esterified with OH group of hexose moiety of the molecule. The clinical aspects as, for example, there's a metachromatic leukodystrophy. And this is an inherited disorder in which sulfatide accumulates in various tissues. The ratio of cerebroside to sulfatide in brain normally is 3:1. However, during this disorder, it is altered to 1:4. It is generally occurred due to the deficiency of enzyme called sulfatase, called as aryl sulfatase A. Another disease called Fabry's disease, which is again an inherited disorder. It is also known as a lipid storage disease. It is because of the alpha galactosidase deficiency, and it results in the accumulation of ceramide trihexoside. Then there is a third, is called Krebs disease. Again, they all are inherited disorder of lipid metabolism. Here it is also a lipid storage disease, and it occurs because of the deficiency of enzyme called galactosidase or beta galactosidase, and it results in the accumulation of galactosyl ceramide. Now, in general, there are a lot of studies which focuses on the lipids as a potential therapeutic targets. For example, here are the list of some of the discoveries and some of the reviews and some of the research which talks about that lipids can be considered as a potential therapeutic targets. For example, the lipids and lipid processing pathways, which are used in drug and delivery and therapeutics. There is the lipid droplet, which is a potential therapeutic target in NAFLD. There are dietary lipids and adipocytes, which are considered as potential therapeutic targets in cancers. There is a targeting of myelin lipid metabolism as a potential therapeutic strategy in a model of neuropathy. And there are a lot of emerging targets in lipid-based therapy. And these are the very good articles to go through and read about more of the lipids and how they can target. In general about the lipids and what are the major important abundant lipids which are needs to be targeted and which are accumulated and what are the pathways, lipid biosynthetic pathways which are, you know, can be targeted for these kind of therapies. Thank you. Follow on ITLS Academy on Insta, Facebook, Twitter and YouTube, and you will find a lot of other lectures about other topics as well. Thank you.